The topic for the today's webinar, Standards on Auditing, Key Considerations in the Financial Statements. I, on behalf of JB Nagar Study Circle, thank you CA Dr. Sanjeev Singhal and CA Parveen Kumar for accepting our invitation for sharing valuable knowledge and information on the topic. I also thank you, past Central Council member, Sanjeev Maheshwari ji, for helping us to arrange the seminar. I now request past convener of JB Nagar Study Circle, CA NM Jain ji, to formally introduce both the speakers.
Thank you, madam. And it is my great honor and privilege to introduce today's two learned speakers. First, I introduce Dr. CA Sanjeev Kumar Singhal. He is a Central Council member. He is a chairman of Sustainability Accounting Standard Board and Vice Chairman of Accounting Standard Board of ICAI. In his educational background, he is FCA with over 20 years of experience, and he is graduate from Sri Ram College of Commerce, Delhi, and is topper there. He has done his articleship with A.F. Ferguson, Delhi. He is MCom from Department of Commerce, Delhi School of Economics. He has done his doctorate in finance from from Faculty of Management Studies, Delhi. He has a certified course on IFRS from ICAI. He has received over 100 merit certificate for academics. His achievement and extracurricular activities like this. He has written over 12 books published by leading publisher, including Bharat Lab House, CCS, Lexis, Nexus, Bloomberg, etc. He has a professional experience in industry experience. He is vice president finance at Cyber Media, executive vice president finance at Religare, vice president at Jubilant Life Science. He has worked partner with BL Agarwal, Sobhavasia and Company. Also worked as an associate professor at Ford School of Management, currently working partner at SR Bartley Bow and Company, Chartered Accountants, and is received so many awards. CA Professional Achievement Award 2014 for outstanding contribution to industry. He's a winner of AB Ghosh Prize for highest marks in economic group papers. He's Delhi University topper, received from Jain Aryan Vyas Gold Medalist. And towards the contribution to the profession, he's a government nominee of NACAS and contributed toward resolving industry and professional interest issue. He's a special invitee of Karo Group set up by MCA. He represented India at World Accounting Forum Dubai and World Standard Setters Meet at London. He's contributed as a convener of 16 study group of ICAI and also brought out 12 standards for local bodies. He is leading the development audit or tool for SMPs. He's contributed and co-opted member at special invitee of Board of Studies ASB, AASB, IND AS Implementation Committee, ITFG, Corporate Law Committee, Research Committee of ICAI. His contribution as a CII nominee on Auditing and Assurance Standard Board of ICAI acted as a resource person for developing several guidance notes. He has contributed as a member of CII National Financial Reporting Committee member, CII National CFO Committee and Chairman, CII Subgroup of Accounting and Auditing Standards on Matters Concerning Industry. He has addressed more than 650 seminars on accounting standard and IND AS, IFRS, IPAS, IPSAS, revised Schedule 6, Schedule 2 of Companies Act 2013, accounting standard, etc. His contribution to society is large. He is a volunteer at CanSport working for cancer patients. He is a trustee of Sri Krishna Ayurvedic Hospital, Charkhi Dadri, Haryana, at Sri Vaishya Vikas Parishad, Delhi. These are the few of his achievements. And now I give introduction of CA Parveen Kumar. CA Parveen Kumar is a senior partner at National Head of Assurance Division of ASA The organization has 8 offices with 700 plus team members. He is over 28 years of post-qualification experience, a commerce graduate, hold diploma in information system audit, besides certification in IFRS UK. Had been a member of NACAS, Auditing Standard Board, AASB, and Expert Advisory Committee beside various research group and committee of Indian CA Institute. Experience of working on large number of risk advisory assignments, audit, forensic fraud investigation, and IFRS transition for various corporates. He is a speaker at national and international forum on the subject of expertise faculty with reputed institutions like IMT, and AAA, ICAI, ICSI, ICWAI, CAG, NIFM, MCA, IICA, DU, etc. Written a book on consideration under IFRS, converged Indian standard beside papers and articles published at various renowned journals and magazines. He is invited to present paper by reputed institution in Japan, Nepal, Myanmar, Dubai, Singapore, beside various large companies and branches at ICAI across the country. His personal hobby include marathon running. And with this, before I hand over to the sir, I just want to have a small issue to address to single sir. Sir, before I really go on to my contention, I give a small example. Sir, in Bombay, there is a good family, this family having over 50 members in his family. And they are very rich. They have food for that whole 15 members, including if any guest comes, they can serve also. But our ruler has given a rule that you can feed only 10 people, whether they are guests, whether they are family members. Now, the head of the family has to decide to whom not to give the food and whom to give the food. This has now, in this context, I want to come to the my subject. Sir, as per study circle guideline, a CP study circle can give credit to only 300 members in a meeting, whether more than 300 attend. Now, it is very difficult for the convener to whom not to give the credit. Sir, there is this guideline may have some considerations. We do not know what are the reasons to frame this law, but I think such issues I have not been received with. So you are a very influential person and you are in Delhi. So please use your good office and try to bring some changes in this criteria so that all the members can get benefit. Because see, in our study circle, we have our 1500 members for so many years. Now, how to refuse them not to attend when they are paying the fees, they are joining with love and affection to the study circle meeting. And after attending the meeting, we say, sorry, we can't give you credit of the CP, which you have attended for a complete 2 hours, 3 hours program, 4 hours, whatever it is. So try and I request you to please do something on this subject. And with this, I hand over it to you, sir. Thanks, sir.
Thank you so much, Navratan Jainji. Your example was really mind-blowing. And so first of all, my thanks to my good friend, Sanjeev Maheshwari Bhai. I know him from last one decade. And it is because of him that I am in this program. And I know his contribution as a chairman of Accounting Standard Board. I've been a great admirer of Sanjeev Bhai. And he is known for taking bold decisions. Some of the decisions which other will not even think of, he will take in the interest of the profession. So my association with him, is based on those sound principles. And I also believe in the same philosophy. And my co-speaker, Praveen Kumarji, in fact, he had to address another program, which was on the certificate course on Ind AS. But I requested him, and he was kind enough to agree to take this session. For him, marathon is a passion. And he's also working with my core group. He's a member, integral member of my core group in Delhi. And he's also working on advising these smaller firms on the merger, because he's the national audit head of a very large firm, ASA and Associate, with more than 700 or 800 members. So he's really doing a great job by advising them on the various nitty-gritties of merger. And my thanks to Seema ji. And I know that she was trying to reach me on phone many times. What has happened is, after COVID-19, because everything is in virtual mode, and people think that now the business will be less. But I can tell you that in ICI, the activity level has gone up multiple times, and almost throughout the day, 7 days a week, something or the other is going on. And similarly for offices also, since my firm, SR Bartleby, which is a part of ENY, is almost fully on the digital mode. So the work is going on, which actually is good. Work from home is going on. So that's why, the time now left for personal purposes is even less what it used to be earlier. And to the question of Navratan Jain ji, let me tell you that Honorable Nehar Jambusaria ji is the convener of the CP committee. He is the vice president. He is from Mumbai. He also has a CP study circle. And I know that in Mumbai, people are passionate about learning. So 342 or 354 people in Delhi, you don't get even if you combine three branches, not to talk of the CP studies circle. So normally this problem is not faced. And there is an impression, and to an extent that is correct also, that people join and then leave by putting the audio video on mute. So the idea was to put some checks and balances, because when you are there personally in the classroom, then maybe a better control is there, but in a virtual mode, maybe this control is missing. So there are sufficient number of digital learning hub programs also. Like from Accounting Standard Board, we have come out with an AS video book. Every accounting standard has been covered in 15 to 20 minutes. And on completion of this video book, you get 10 structured CP hours. And there are no charges also. So similarly, almost all the committees have come out with the structured learning hours in the form of video book. So the members can complete the structured learning hours through those also. Of course, maximum limit is 10 as of now, up to 30th June. But looking into the situation, we may be increasing it soon. Maybe it is increased to 15. Because this year, I think up to September, it is the virtual mode only which will be prevalent because of COVID-19. So while this issue can certainly be taken up, I told you that I think apart from Mumbai, this is nowhere the case. Normally in study circle, 50 people, 40 people, at the most 100 people generally are joining. As far as this video book is concerned, I'll forward it to Sanjeev Maheshwari Bhai, that what is the link, because one member has asked this query. Although it is available on Digital Learning Hub, if you will log in using your credential of SSP portal, you will be able to find it. But still, I'll send you that brochure. And for unstructured CP hours, we have done many programs this time. We have done a four-day program as a refresher course on accounting standard. We have done a four-day program on the commonly observed errors in application of accounting standards. So all these initiatives have been taken. And of course, COVID-19 has been, it is a global pandemic. It is spreading its wings in India, particularly Delhi and Mumbai. It is really a cause of concern. But hats off to all our members that who have made sure that this adversity is converted into an opportunity. And the learning quotient has been greatly enhanced during this lockdown. And my sincere advice will be to stick to the ground rule. Do real learning, which all of you are doing. And I also like this Code of Ethics film, actually. For the first time, I've seen it. And I could also make out that this is being played in Mumbai. So the Hindi song was also there in the background. And the song was really good. So this is really a nice way of, you know, imbibing the ethics, which are fortunately, unfortunately, are sorely missing in many walks of life now. But we stand committed to the professional ethics, and this our code of ethics has also been revised, which is likely to be made applicable on July 1, 2020. However, because of COVID, maybe that, you know, we may consider postponing it also by a few months. That is under the active consideration as well. So on this CP, I will speak to Nihar Bhai. That's the way we address our council colleagues. So similarly, Sanjeev Bhai, I call him, I don't call him Sanjeev Maheshwari. I would request Sanjeev Bhai also to speak to Nihar Bhai on this issue. And I'm sure because he know that people in Mumbai actually join and are very attentive. So maybe this facility of having more than 300 is also extended. Now, I come to the topic, and you can make it as interactive as you would like it to be. We will try to weave the auditing standards into a story to the extent possible, because auditing is a very dry subject, and auditing standard at times is really, our member find it painful to learn because it's totally theory. And what happens is that when we are doing audits over a long period of time, we find, we think that we know everything. So what an auditing standard will teach us? No, no, this can't teach us anything. But that's not right. And we realize it's important. So that is why we made four structured CP hours on accounting standard, auditing standard, and code of ethics mandatory. So that, you know, even if forcefully, members attend these programs. So let us take a story that XYZ chartered accountants got a call from a company saying that 5 years are over for our previous auditor. Two terms of 5 years are over. And now as per the Companies Act, we need to change our auditors. So, you know, and we have gone through your profile, the profile of your firm, profile of your partners, your staff strength, etc. So would you like to be our auditors? Although in the present life, and I know Praveen ji is smiling, you know, you have to actually make presentation before the client. There are RFPs which are floated, and there's a fierce competition which happens. But let us say on the lines of central statutory audit or the CNAG audit, you get an offer from the company that would you like to be appointed as an auditor? You check your limits. Do you have enough limits? Now, how do you check your limits? You check the number of audits which can be done by per partner. So per partner, you can do 20 audits under the Companies Act and 30 audits as per ICAI guidelines. But in Companies Act, some small audits of small private companies are excluded. So it is whichever is lower. It's not that if the ICAI code of ethics says 30, Companies Act says 20, so you can do 30. No. When ICAI ethics code of ethics says 30, it means including all private companies and everything, you can do 30. And out of which 20 will not be more than what is prescribed under the Companies Act. Or say, for example, if you are doing the audit of non-corporate entities, say like Mata Vaishno Devi Trust, now that is not a company. So that will also be counted in the limit of 30. Let us say you checked I use the term PPD, Professional Practice Directorate. You can have any other name in your firm. So he looked into it and he checks that there are 10 partners in the firm. We have, 195 audits. So fine, this audit can also be done. So you give your letter of willingness to the company that, you know, if we are appointed, it will be within the limits as defined under the Companies Act. Now, one of your new partner asks you a question that I'm already doing 20 audits. Now you're saying that I should do this audit. Is it allowed? So then we go by again the rule book and check number of audits per partner is actually a limit for the firm. However, an individual partner can do more than the prescribed limit also. However, the firm as a whole cannot exceed that limit. So his answer is given, and fine, the firm gives a go-ahead to the company. Now, company places the willingness of the auditor before the audit committee, and the board also approves the appointment of the auditor, and the shareholders approves the appointment of the auditor for a period of 5 years. Now you receive the intimation from the company that you can be that you have been appointed as an auditor. Now you go by your code of ethics and communicate with the with your predecessor that through by asking an NOC from the auditor that if that's that we have been appointed as an auditor by the company, we would like to know that do you have any professional reasons to tell us that whether we should accept this engagement or not. Now let us say the predecessor was ABC Chartered Accountants. The predecessor doesn't respond to you, say within 7 days. You then again write a reminder to him, and this time he writes that yes, I have no professional objection in your going ahead with the auditor of the company. Or he may say that I have no problem, however my fees has not been paid. Or he may say that I have no problem, however we would like you to go through our audit report on the financial statement for the year ended so and so, which have been issued on this particular date, and the UDIN is so and so. So in the first case, there was no problem when there was a clean NOC. In the second case, when the fees is pending, actually I feel that one should take up this matter as a matter of professional courtesy with the company that kindly pay his fee. If I am the auditor, I may not accept the audit engagement if you have not paid the fee to my predecessor auditor. However, this is not compulsory, but as a firm, we follow this practice. Third, if he is inviting my attention to the audit report, I'll go through the audit report. It is possible that in the audit report, there are severe adverse remarks, there are major qualifications, or there are instances of fraud which have been reported. In that case, I'll take my professional judgment whether those are acceptable to me in terms of the risk that will be there in the audit of financial statements, whether that risk is up to an acceptable level or not. If I feel that it's an acceptable level, or if I feel that by giving a similar qualifications, I'll still be doing my duty, I will go ahead. But otherwise, there are instances where my firm or I have refused to carry out those audits based on the previous audit reports. Yet, of course, based on previous audit reports, I'll discuss it with the management. And it is not necessary that you have to say no if there are adverse remarks. So this, you as an auditor have to assess that whether it is acceptable to you or not. Because as per SA 200, objective of financial statements, the job of an auditor is to express his opinion on the true and fair view of the financial statements, whether the financial statement reflect a true and fair view or not of the state of affairs of the company and the result of operations of the company. Now, once I am through with this exercise, then what I'll do, I will issue an engagement letter to the company. And since Praveen Kumarji is there, he's available, I would ask him whether he would like to spend a few minutes on engagement letter so that we continue with this story. Otherwise, I can skip this part and we can come back to you on engagement letter. Praveen ji.
Yeah, so engagement letter is very critical part, and it is mandatory for all of us to obtain the engagement letter. So I'll share my presentation, I'll delve a little more into this. And I think, Sanjeevji, it is a good idea. Please continue with the story. It is becoming very
interesting. Sure. So, engagement letter has been executed and then the work starts. In some cases, it is possible that for practical purposes, engagement letter is signed a bit late. But then it must be signed before you have started working on it. Now, what I'll do is, so while SA210 on engagement letter will be covered by Praveen Kumarji. Now what I'll do is I'll apply SA300 on audit planning. But before audit planning, I'll also use this as an opportunity to see whether my firm is compliant with SQC1. And SQC1 is very, very important. It talks about certain fundamental principles which must be there in every firm. I don't know how many of you have the opportunity to go through the NFRA report on IFIN. It's a very, very damaging report for the profession. And I don't agree with many of the observations of NFRA, personally speaking. But the way it talks about SQC1, or if your firm has gone through the process of peer review, or QRB, then you are asked for documentation relating to SQC1. SQC1 stands for Standard on Quality Control, and it deals with quality control for firms that perform audits and reviews of historical financial information and other assurance and related service engagement. So you call a meeting of the partners and you see whether we are compliant with SQC1 or not. And in that meeting, one of your partner or manager gives a presentation on SQC1, the way it happens in the firm ASA. Praveen Kumarji organizes almost every week these kind of programs. So he explains that there are 6 attributes which are defined in SQC1. These are leadership responsibilities for quality control, that who in the firm has overall responsibility for quality control. So actually, I'll suggest that you designate a quality control leader within a firm. Now, it may so happen that I receive a response that, sir, mine is a sole proprietorship firm, or I have a 2 partners firm. How can I do all this? Well, audit quality matters do not depend on the size of the firm. So that is why we say that the work that you take should be commensurate with your experience and size. And that's why we strongly encourage merger of firms. The merger which I, along with Praveen Kumarji, we are working for our small and mid-sized practitioner in Delhi. In fact, they want to have a branch in Mumbai also. As many as 37 partners are interested in that merger. And if that happens, this will be among India's top 20 firms by size. So there's a huge opportunity and there's a huge need also. Because otherwise, how you are going to satisfy all these requirements? The next element of SQC1 is ethical requirements. That is, we have to satisfy the ethical requirements for all the members of the audit team and all the members of the audit firm. And it should be ensured that the communication of the quality control policies of that firm has been done to all. And you should also seek a formal feedback on the quality control system from the various employees of the firm and including the interns of the firm. And I can tell you that SQC1 requires that the CEO or the managing partner should assume the ultimate responsibility for the quality control, and one should recognize and reward high quality work. The performance measurement of the audit partners cannot be based on the volume of business generated, irrespective of whatever you do, but you cannot document that the audit partners have been rewarded on the basis of volume of business brought by them. Then what SQC1 also advocates, that you should do training, seminars, meetings, formal, informal dialogues, and at the same time, you must document them. So now there are softwares available for all these processes. And if they are not available, you find a way that how do you document? Like in my firm, we have a norm that each person is to be trained for at least 40 hours in 1 year. Now these 40 hours could be firm's internal hours or the institute CP hours as well. So there are certain mandatory trainings, and we have also made it mandatory that each member of the firm will also impart 8 hours of training. Now this 40 and 8 is your own assessment. You can make it 30 and 5, 30 and 10, 50 and 5, whatever you want. But have some policy and monitor people, include it in their performance assessment as well, that they are measured against completion of training and imparting training to others. Incorporate in your internal documentation, incorporate in your employee policy and in the appraisal document. And then what you should do, your HR policy should demonstrate that firm is committed to the quality controls. So this should be actually one of the parameters for performance appraisal as well. And the person who is authorized by the CEO or the managing partner of the firm for quality control leadership should be given sufficient authority as well. And then now the presenter also tells you that in SQC1, the next element of quality control is the ethical requirements. And ethics demands integrity, objectivity, professional competence, confidentiality, and professional behavior. Now, professional competence, obviously the person should be a subject matter expert of that area. Confidentiality. Recently, you would have seen that in case of Bata, SEBI has imposed a fine of 15 lakh rupees over the leakage of information on WhatsApp. So what happens at times is there is a communication going on WhatsApp. Oh, I need this file. Send it to me in Gmail. Send it to me in WhatsApp. Never, ever allow that. Never, ever. It should be sent on the official mail ID. Now, actually, nowadays, I face a problem. Because many times, if I have to take a print and I'm at home, I'm not able to connect my laptop to the printer. Maybe I've not taken the help of my technical advisor. I'll do that. But then at times there's a temptation to transfer it to Gmail, but that is not possible. So, and WhatsApp is a big no. I can tell you, never ever share client information on WhatsApp. You will not be able to escape the responsibility if anything wrong goes or it happens. And ethical requirements also ensures independence. Now, one of your team members asked you, what is independence? So, well, independence is actually a state of mind, but it has to be demonstrated also. And how do you demonstrate? Let us say, now, Sanjeev Maheshwariji is a director of SBI. So, can he do the audit of SBI? Answer is no, because he will not be treated as independent of the State Bank of India. Similarly, if I have to do audit of PQR Limited, and it's a listed entity, if any of my partner hold share in that PQR Limited, I as a firm, my firm cannot accept the audit of that PQR Limited until he sells all those shares. That much I can tell you. So like we have a rule that in case we accept an audit, if any partner or any team member holds these shares in that company, then you will have to sell those shares. And if at any time a person acquires by mistake, then you resign from that audit, because there is no other way. No other way. An independent should be documented. What you should do is take an annual independence letter, which is to be signed by every member of your firm, including the interns. And while starting any audit, take independence confirmation from all those who will be engaged on that audit. So whether it is your IT team, whether it is your tax team or GST team, I mean, if you have all them as a part of audit team, or your audit partner or audit manager or interns, all have to sign that independence before you commence any audit, that we are independent of the company that we are auditing, and it should be documented. Then, and as I said, take the annual return confirmation also. And you should also address familiarity threat. Now, what is familiarity threat? Familiarity threat is created when you continue the same people and assurance engagements year after year. So SQC1 says, for audit of listed entities, rotate your partner once in 7 years, at least once in 7 years. Now you will say that term is 5 years, but there can be two appointments of 5 year each. So maximum within 7 years, you must rotate your partner. You can rotate him earlier also. Then the third element of SQC1 is client acceptance and the continuance. Now, so you must take into account that, or you must assess actually that about the integrity of the client. For example, many firms don't undertake the audit of companies who sell lotteries or who are in gambling, because in some of the countries, even gambling is allowed. So you have to see that if as a principal, you are not auditing any of the company, or say some companies say that if some audit firm will say if a company has been, if the company's personnel has been convicted for, say, money laundering, then they will not undertake those audits. So check for your firm policy or make a firm policy if it doesn't have, and think whether you should accept the client or not. And then obviously you should also look at the reputation of the management, the nature of the operation, the attitude of the owners towards the internal controls or towards the corporate governance, etc. And whether there have been any removal of the previous auditors. If there have been removal, it could be a warning sign that maybe everything was not well. And if there are at times you feel that it is necessary to withdraw from engagement for certain reasons, you should withdraw also. However, that amounts to resignation. And now resignation is covered by very stringent requirement, particularly if you are talking about the listed entities. And then you should assign the audit to your team members based on the competence. ऐसा नहीं हो कि एक आर्टिकल को बोले जा बेटा जाके तू सारे काम करा और जब तेरा ऑडिट खत्म हो जाए मुझे बुला लियो मैं रिव्यू के लिए आ जाऊंगा. नो, दैट कैनॉट हैपन. यू मस्ट प्लान द ऑडिट, सुपरवाइज द ऑडिट, रिव्यू द ऑडिट. एंड लेट मी ऑल्सो टेल यू, इन केस ऑफ लिस्टेड एंटिटीज यू ऑल्सो नीड टू हैव एन EQR. EQR इज एन एंगेजमेंट क्वालिटी रिव्यूअर. See, if I am the partner and if Praveen Kumarji is a partner in my firm, then if I am doing the audit, then he will review my work as an EQR. This is mandatory under the SQC1. There has to be an EQR in case of a listed entity. He will supervise my work. He will review the key judgments. He will review the key risk area. और ऐसा नहीं है कि उससे मैं तो अपनी रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी से फ्री हो गया कि प्रवीण कुमार जी रिस्पॉन्सिबल. नो, बोथ ऑफ अस रिमेन रिस्पॉन्सिबल. एंड इन वन ऑफ द डिसिप्लिनरी केस इन द इंस्टीट्यूट वी रिसेंटली हेल्ड दैट ए पार्टनर इज रिस्पॉन्सिबल एंड इफ पार्टनर वॉज डिबार्ड फ्रॉम डूइंग प्रैक्टिस फॉर 5 years, EQR वॉज ऑल्सो डिबार्ड फॉर 1 year और 2 year. सो EQR इज नॉट इक्वली रिस्पॉन्सिबल, बट ही इज रिस्पॉन्सिबल एंड ही विल नॉट बी एबल टू एस्केप his responsibility. And of course, it also talks about documentation and monitoring. So these are the 6 key elements of SQC1. Very, very important. Whenever a peer review or a QRB or an inspection by NAFRA happens, this is usually the starting point. Now, Now, it is possible. See, as your firm grows, you may not be able to do anything in the pen and paper mode. You establish a portal, like we have a portal. Issued is also making an audit tool for its members. However, in fact, I started this, but as some of you would know, that the committees change every year. So this time, this responsibility is with someone else. But the process is on. Once that software is in place, it will make life of particularly the SMPs easier. However, till that time, we cannot say that software is not provided by ICI, so we are not able to do that. No, you have to document what way you want to document, that is for you to see. Now, what I'll do is that I have been receiving some questions so far. So if Seema ji want, or if Sanjeev Maheshwari bhai suggest, we can take up some questions now, or do I continue with my story?
Actually, I am compiling the questions. So at the end, I will share the screen.
You can answer. Sure. Right. Thank you. So now, moving ahead with our story, that once the engagement team has discussed that SQC1 we are complied with, then what next? Then we do the audit planning. Now, in audit planning, what you do is we make an audit planning memorandum. We call it APM. You can call something else also. There is no problem. In audit planning, what I'll say is that these are the areas, because of the nature of the industry or the nature of business of the company, I found that these are high risk areas. Say, for example, and now, particularly because of COVID-19, there are chances that to maintain share price, a company may like to manipulate its earnings. Or maybe it thinks reverse, that in the name of COVID, everything will be accepted. Let us understate the profits. Let us underreport the sales and move it to the next year. Save for the rainy day. Now, in audit planning, I must be able to identify the key risk areas and also identify which area I want to focus and who will do what audit. Say, for example, who will do cash verification, who will observe stock taking, who will observe fixed asset verification, who will do the vouching, who will do bank reconciliation statement, who will do the sales audit, purchases audit, IT audit, who will review direct tax computation, who will reconcile GST returns with the revenue, who will go through the notes, who will go through the schedules, who will do the linking, who will check the cash flow statement, P&L, balance sheet, etc. So in audit planning, you allocate those responsibilities among the team members based on their competence. And also say, who will review the work? Say, for example, who will review the work of an intern and who will review the work of the manager? And ultimately, it is the partner who is going to be responsible for all the work done. Also document the time estimated for the audit. Say, for example, if you're receiving 5 lakh rupees fees and you develop a criteria that normally 1,000 per hour is our recovery rate. So it's a 500 hour audit. And if it's a 500 hour audit, normally my mix will be that, say, 60% time will be spent by interns, 20% or 25% time will be spent by manager, 10% time will be spent by a director, and 5% time will be spent by a partner. Or the levels, if the levels are less, if the hierarchy is less, then this time will change accordingly. You must budget the time budget and the cost budget. See, in UK, what has started now, in UK now, an audit firm has to demonstrate. They will also write in the annual financial statement that they have to give an undertaking that audit was not done at a loss. We may say, audit mein loss kahan se aayega? Hamare to log hain, wo cost hai, hum koi manufacturing organization thodi na jo loss aayega. Nahin. Hamare employees ki cost hoti hai. So you must work out a chargeable rate, that what is the rate that you should charge. And I tell you that how you can monitor your firm's progress. You work out a recovery per hour, RPH. and compare it, and I can tell you, see, for example, if your revenue of your firm, the gross fees is, say, for example, 2 crore rupees, and if you have 10 employees, on an average, an employee works 1800 hours in a year. Whatever you do, average comes around 1600 to 2000. Most likely it is 1800. Whatever calculation you may do. 1800 hours, 10 people, 18,000 hours. So 2 crore is the fee. Your average comes to 1100 rupees. If it comes 1100, I can tell you it is extremely, extremely good. Normally, in a large firm, this average would come anywhere between 1500 to 2000. In a mid-sized firm, it could range around 1000 to 1200. And in smaller size firms, it could be anywhere between 400 to 800. Focus on increasing this RPH by asking for more fee, by automating your audit processes. Some of the process, if you automate, your time spent on those areas will go down. You can take the help of Excel also. In fact, we have a very good faculty, CA Vijay Agarwalji, who's my neighbor and who takes up lots of session on my YouTube channel also. There are a few sessions of Vijay Agarwalji which is there. He also has a website. He tells you how to do the jobs, days works in hours and hour works in minutes. So you can automate some of your processes and reduce your time spent. And still, you will be able to do a good quality work. Say, for example, I tell you, like SA 520 talks about analytical procedures. So in audit planning stage itself, in SA 300, you should identify in which areas you will apply this SA 520 on analytical procedure. See, for example, on the profit and loss account particularly, you can apply this auditing standard and do an analytical review of the expenses. Say, for example, what I do is I draw a common size statement. In a common size statement, I reduce everything in terms of revenue, as a percentage of revenue. I take revenue as 100 and then compute all expenses as a percentage of revenue and compare the 2 years to see how do they compare and look for the variations. And then for the absolute amounts also, I look for the variations and the reasons for the change. For example, if the employee expense, earlier it was 10 crores, now it is 14 crores, then this 4 crore has to be explained in terms of maybe 10 new employees have been added, leading to a cost of 1.5 crores, maybe 10% increment was given, leading to additional cost of 50 lakhs, and maybe during the year, actuarial assumptions have changed, leading to an increase of 1 crore, but I'm still left to explain 1 crore. And maybe 5 employees have left, which have reduced the salary by 50 lakh. So there's a 1.5 crore of unexplained variation in the payroll expense. I must investigate it. I must find out why this difference is there. Plus, other areas where I can analyze, I can use my data analytical skill. And I can tell you that even if you may not have a sophisticated data analytical tool, but of all of us have MS Excel. And MS Excel is a very good data analytical tool. What you should also do, in fact, I sincerely urge, all of us should have original MS Office 365 license. It gives you so many things. And also now it gives you the facility of Teams, like we have this Zoom. It gives you access to Teams on which as many as 10,000 people can join. And there are no charges for joining. That's similar to this Zoom, and rather I'll say better quality audio video conferencing tool. So use the original versions. Your data will not be corrupted. Now in MS Excel, what you can do, some of the data analytical, what you can do. Say, for example, you are doing the audit of a large bank. Say, for example, you're doing the audit of State Bank of India with 50,000 employees. Employees may be more. I'm just taking a guess. You want to find out, are there any dummy employees? Aapne Excel mein usko sare employees ka master liya, and you are putting a command in Excel that is the PAN number of any of the two employees is same. It will give you the result within fraction of seconds. Or what you do is you check is the address of two employees same? Maybe possible that husband and wife are working or son and father are working in the same bank. But at least you will get to know. You also compare it with the vendor master. Check whether the PAN number of a vendor and employee is same. You check the address that whether the address of an employee or vendor is same. You check whether the bank account of an employee or vendor is same. And all this data analytics, I can tell you, if you put it in Excel properly, it will take less than one hour to do this data analytics. Similarly, one can apply the JE testing tools, journal entry testing tool, and one can look for keywords. Like when we were students, we used to see normally frauds happens at isolated time or on isolated days. For example, if you find ke Sunday ko sabse zyada entry ho rahi hai, journal entry ho rahi hai, ya raat ko 11 baje journal entry ho rahi hai. So one impression could be that that person is very hard working. Sunday ko bhi aata hai, raat ko 11 baje tak kaam karta hai, but at the same time, it may also happen that, you know, all the frauds are done when no one else is around. So have a watch on that. Get a listing of those entities, those entries, and analyze those entries. Plus, what you can also do, look for the narration like as instructed by management, or bribery, or forgery, or fraud, or as advised by management, or cash paid. Look for certain keywords and analyze those journal entries. And particularly look for the entries which are passed on 31st March, because these are the adjustment entries. And many times we find that pure saal mein jitni entry hain, 31st March ko bhi utni entry hoti hai. So you must look at these. So in audit planning, take care that all these things are addressed. Now I come to two, again, very, very important auditing standard, materiality and audit sampling. Ab aapne audit planning kar li, apni audit team ko audit pe bheja. And you have given them a guru mantra ki material item koi bhi mat chhodna. Because all accounting standard and auditing standards are based on the principle of materiality. Now your manager asks, sir, what is material? How do I define materiality? And how do I pick up sample? Kis area ke kitne sample pick karne hai? Then I say, look, my friend, we have to apply SA 320 and SA 530. And now I'll explain ke wo partner ne apne manager ko kya explain kiya. He says, look, materiality will depend which stage of operation the company is in. If the company is still into the construction stage, go for an asset-based materiality. If the company is fully operational but not having stable profits, go for revenue-based materiality. And if the company is in operating stage and there are stable profits, go for profit-based materiality. We decided that company is doing well for last so many years, profits are stable, let us take a materiality based on the profit before tax. So suppose the profit of the revenue of the company was 100 crores and profit of the company was 10 crores, profit before tax. And we decided, let us take 5% of profit before tax. Normally it is 5 to 10%. Let us take 5% of profit before tax as something which is material. So 10 crore was the profit, 5% of that is 50 lakhs. So this becomes my performance materiality or planning materiality. This is also called overall materiality. Then I work out tolerable error, TE. Now TE is between 50% to 75% of planning materiality. Again, if it's a risky client, if your risk perception is high, go for a lower TE. If risk perception is low, go for a higher TE. Let us say the risk perception is low and you go for 75% of your PM as the TE. 10 crore was the profit before tax, 50 lakh was the performance materiality, 75% of 50 lakh, 37.5 lakh will be the tolerable error. It means up to 37.5 lakh only you can tolerate the error. Isse upar hui to ya to management ko rectification entry pass karni padegi or you'll have to qualify your accounts. Then you compute SAD. SAD is summary of audit differences, and SAD is 5% of planning materiality. My planning materiality was 50 lakh. 5% of 50 lakh will come to 2.5 lakh. any item below SAT, any error below SAT, below 2.5 lakh, you can simply ignore. There is absolutely no problem. You can say these are unadjusted item. Actually, no one is bothered about the items below SAT. At times it happens, if you're talking about, say, Indian Oil with a revenue of 5 lakh crore and say 50,000 crore profit, and one will say 5,000 crore of PM and 5% of that 250 crore rupees SAT, we'll say 250 crore se kam ki error aap chhod denge. Yes, because you have to look at the size of the revenue and profit of the firm also. You can leave those errors. Otherwise, you cannot check every transaction. So now, what happens is that there is SAT, there is T, there is PM. What you should do is, any error between SAT and T that you bring to the attention of those charged with governance, that is management of the company or the audit committee of the company. And they have an option either to rectify it. Now, sometimes people ask, is it individual error or cumulative error? Cumulative error, my friend. You cannot say individual errors, 2.5 lakh, 2.5 lakh, 100 error you can make and you can leave all those errors. No. Cumulatively, the error should not exceed the TE. And if they exceed the TE, the company must rectify the amount exceeding TE or the whole amount. Or if they don't, then you should qualify your audit report. Now, you tell to your team that now pick up the samples based on these materiality threshold, and anything about TE, you must check 100%. So even if there are 1,000 individual transactions about TE, we have to check 100%. Rather, in our firm, we also use a table which says if it's an asset or a liability account, then any item above 50% of TE, so in TE was 37.5 lakh. Any individual item above 18.75 lakh, we check 100%. Similarly, on the P&L side, any expense above 25% of TE, say 37.5 lakh cut 25% aapne nikala, so 9.375 lakh. Any individual item above 9.375 lakh, you must check 100%. And then for the remaining item, TE stands for tolerable error. Now, for the remaining items, we apply sampling. Now, what is sampling and how sampling is done and how many samples to be taken? Earlier, this guidance was missing. But when we came out with this guidance note on internal control over financial reporting, then for controls, it gave a guidance that if it's an annual control, you have to check one sample. Obviously, annual control, you will be able to check only once. So deferred tax computation, the company is making annually. So obviously, you will check that one sample. Secondly, if there are quarterly controls, say for example, quarterly provisions are made, you must check at least two samples, that is two quarters. If it's a monthly control, for example, bank reconciliation statement, every month the company is making, again, you must check at least two samples, that is 2 months. If it's a weekly control, for example, payment of overtime wages, you must check at least 5 samples. If it is daily control, operating once a day, for example, you are making payment once a day, then you must check at least 15 samples. If it's a control operating multiple times a day, for example, sales are booked multiple times a day, say there are 20 sales voucher every day, you must check at least 25 samples. And then people ask, what happens if I found an error in one sample that I checked? Then you increase it to 40 if it was 25. If you find one more error, you increase it to 60. If you find one more error, do not rely on controls. Do a substantive testing instead of control testing. Now, people also ask, and this in audit sampling also, there are various ways of doing sampling. There is judgmental sampling. There is haphazard sampling. There is statistical sampling. What I always prefer is a statistical sampling or a formula-driven sampling. Now, you may say, we do not have tools like you. No problem. All of you have Excel. So what you should do is, suppose there are 10,000 sales voucher, go to Excel sheet, write 1, 2, select both 1 and 2, drag it to 10,000. Computer will automatically write up to 10,000. Now go to the 10,000 oneth row and say equal to, and apply the formula of random and say कंप्यूटर जी 25 रैंडम नंबर जनरेट कर दीजिए, जस्ट लाइक अमिताभ बच्चन सेज कौन बनेगा करोड़पति, एंड कंप्यूटर विल जनरेट 25 नंबर्स, रैंडम नंबर्स, एंड दीज आर द रैंडम नंबर्स विच आर योर सैंपल्स विच यू शुड चेक एंड यू शुड डॉक्यूमेंट. Our auditing standard on documentation is very, very clear that you must document whatever you have done or whatever you are doing. Audit evidence, SA 500 is on audit evidence and SA 230 is on documentation, that how you got that evidence and what you document. There is a Hindi kahawat, pehle likh fir de, bhool pade to bahi se le, means first write then give. If there is an error, check from your books of accounts. So that you must do. You must write what was the scope of work, what were the audit steps that you have undertaken, and what you checked, what were the samples checked, and what are your observations, and how you resolve them, or how you are taking care of them in your audit report. Now, apart from in control testing, you will do an in-depth checking. Now, people at times also ask whether in audit documentation, do we have to keep a copy of all the vouchers that we have checked? Answer is no. You can keep some representative sample. None of our auditing standards says that you have to keep copies of all the documents. For the substantive test, we normally apply a table. A table is applied based on whether there's a minimal risk or there's a low risk or there's a moderate risk or there's a high risk. And based on whatever percentage we have checked through the samples exceeding the tolerable error, then we check how much, say, if we have checked 20% of the total population, 30% of the total population in value, then our table tells us how many more samples are to be checked. It could be 20, 30, 60, 100. 100 is the maximum number that I remember in the table that we use for any particular area. And we check those samples and then, you know, arrive at a conclusion that this is the coverage that we have done. So that is a sufficient coverage. Now, during COVID-19, one auditing standard have become very relevant. Of course, all audit standards are relevant, but this is SA 570, which is going concern. Now, going concern, at times, normally we don't give much of an emphasis. And accounting standard one also says, accounting standard, not auditing standard. Accounting standard one says that there are three fundamental accounting assumptions in the audit of a financial statement. And these are going concern, consistency, and accrual. So you must check whether the enterprise has any intention of materially curtailing its operation or liquidating its operation in the foreseeable future, and which must be at least 12 months. So that we must check, that at least in the next 12 months, whether the enterprise has any intention of ceasing its operations. And it is very important now, where the time of COVID, we just don't do a blind audit. We look at the industry report, for example, the credit rating agencies, large firms, the Chamber of Commerce, etc., have come out with their industry reports, how tourism sector looks like, how real estate sector looks like, hospitality, automobile, pharma, oil and gas. There are various sector-wise reports. How much funds do they have? Now, what you should do is, say if it's a tour and travel, you should apply more sensitivity analysis, and that too more on the conservative side. Give less weightage to maybe management's estimate and more weightage to the sensitivity analysis that you do. Apply multiple scenarios and work out the projected cash flows and the present value of those cash flows. Also look at कि अगले कितने महीने के फंड्स कंपनी के पास हैं. सपोज द फिक्स्ड कॉस्ट ऑफ ऑपरेशंस फॉर वन ईयर इज 5 crore. हाउ मच लिक्विड फंड्स द कंपनी हैज, और वेदर द कंपनी हैज एक्सेस टू द बोरिंग सोर्स और नॉट, और वेदर इट विल बी एबल टू रेज फंड्स और नॉट. सो दैट वी शुड डू, एंड अकॉर्डिंगली वी शुड वर्क आउट दैट वेदर द एंटिटी कंटिन्यूज टू बी अ गोइंग कंसर्न और नॉट. एंड लेट मी फ्रेंड, If an error is made here, we may end up classifying that the company continues to be a going concern, whereas the company may not be a going concern. And then the very basis of preparation of accounts will go wrong. So we must ensure, because if going concern nahi hai, then the accounts are to be prepared on the liquidation basis, which means that assets will be stated at the realizable amount and the liabilities will have to be stated at the amount expected, amount required to settle, expected amount required to settle those liabilities. So, and then SA 505 also during your audit, you should keep in mind, which is external confirmations. We must always obtain 100% bank balance confirmations, and we must also float balance confirmation to 60-70% of the material debtors. And if the debtors do not give a confirmation, send them a reminder. If they don't reply again, at least check the subsequent collection from the debtors. And if you're still not satisfied, then ask for a provision for doubtful debts to be made. And post these letters directly under your hand. And in the digital era and in the COVID era, if you're not able to post the physical letters, post the electronic letters. From your mail IDs, your business domain IDs, I will not prefer Gmail or Yahoo Mail or the open platform IDs. And also, it will be better if they are sending from their domain IDs if they have. And for bank, in any case, don't accept if it comes from a general mail ID. It must come from a domain, a business domain ID. So this way, then you complete your audit. The work is reviewed by the partner and some conclusions are arrived at. I'll stop at this point because so far we have not taken up any questions. So maybe we take up question now, or maybe Praveen Kumarji continues with his part of the story. And I can tell you, I mean, I have also not thought of that. I will share the auditing standard in a story format. I just thought that maybe members will be able to, I'll be able to keep their interests alive. So this is how I built it, the audit procedure. And I would rather leave it to Seema ji to decide whether Praveen Kumar ji finishes his portion in next 30 to 40 minutes. And then last 15 minutes we keep for questions, or do we take the questions now? Thank you very much.
Sir, you want to take the questions? Five questions are there.
Sure.
What do you prefer? Should we question?
So fine. I'll take up those questions. Okay. A question from Akshay is, what if the relative of the partner holds shares of audit client? Well, if that relative is, spouse is generally not a relative, is a close family member, but yes, spouse, children, whether married or unmarried, brother, sister, whether married or unmarried, father and mother. If they hold shares, then you cannot do the audit. Very harsh, but true. Then, yes, so none of the family member of the team member can also not hold shares in the company. Then what step issued has taken against member involved in ILFS, DFHL, Punjab and Sindh Bank? Well, there are two stories, and normally what happens is that when an audit failure, as a large firm, as an auditor, we say that auditor should be fired. And when, you know, the large firm is not the auditor, there are other firms who are the auditor, then, you know, we try and say that the entity was at fault. I think both the extremes are wrong. In Punjab and Sindh Bank is one extreme, then ILFS and DFHL are other extremes. Let us not arrive at a conclusion just like that. There is a disciplinary mechanism of the issue. Then there is NFRA now. There is a QRB. Let them complete their process and issue, of course, based on the disciplinary proceeding, does take action. Now, those firms who do not have website, which mail ID to use, it's very simple. Nowadays, even Google gives you an ID for 1500 rupees a year. So I think all of us should have a domain ID. SAD is summary of audit differences, which I said, normally we take 5% of the planning materiality as SAD. And Vinita has asked a question, COVID-19 notes for reference, where can we find an ICI website? Now, we have made one homepage for COVID-19 related announcement for members and students. So as many as 6 announcement and guidance have been posted on the accounting and auditing matter, you can find from there. And Vidya is asking a question, how frequently the independence declarations are taken? Once a year, and every time you start an audit. Once a year from all members of the audit firm, and every time from the team members of that audit. So if an audit team is doing 10 audits, 10 times for that particular time, and it's only at the time of starting the service, then certainly yes. Bhaveshji has expressed his thanks. I'm thankful to all of you. So thank you very much, Seemaji. With this, I have taken up questions.
One more question.
Okay, sure.
In case of a private limited company, balance sheet, which has only 2-3 transactions. First question, actually, I have to share the screen. Whether it is...
Yeah, I have seen. So I will take up all the questions. In case of private limited company, balance sheet has only 2-3 transactions in 1 year. Do we have to consider any notes, etc.? No. You, of course, whatever accounting policies are required, whatever notes are required, that you do, and your audit report will also be normal. But just make sure that it should not be a defunct company. It should not be a shell company. That you should make sure. Then second, even if there is no reference by predecessor auditor to audit report issued by him, is it not mandatory to review the previous report? No. And for private companies, you will not even have access to the audit reports. For listed companies, you should. But if you say whether it is mandatory or not, the answer is no, it is not mandatory. Third,
same
even way. Family, third has been done, fourth has been done. Fifth, what happens if difference of opinion between engagement partner and quality review partner? In that case, that difference should be recorded in writing. It will be safer for engagement partner to resolve that difference. However, the engagement partner has the final call and he may still decide to go ahead with his audit report. Seemaji, what is timing it is? It's exactly 12:15. I was supposed to speak till 12:15. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Now we will hear Arvind Kumarji.
So thank you so much, Sanjeevji. Actually, the story was so interesting that I think all the participants, they wanted the story to continue, basically. Because you can see it on the chat also, people are mentioning that it's too good. So, but since we have discussed, some part has to be spoken by me. So I have made a small presentation. If you allow, I will share the screen.
Yes, sir, you may share your screen.
Okay, so, So basically, I have picked up only three areas. One is SA210, which is agreeing upon the terms of engagement. SA580, which is written representation, and then guidance note on certificates. So this is an overview of the auditing standards, which we had discussed. There are standards which are issued by AASB. So these standards can be bifurcated into two areas. One is the assurance service and the other is related service. Framework of assurance engagement is the framework under which these standards are issued for assurance. And this can be further divided into two areas, audit and review of historical financial information, or other than audit or review of historical financial information. So basically, if you see the standards on auditing, they come as standard on auditing, standard on review engagement, standard on assurance engagement, and standards on related services. So your numbering of standards, that numbering is also like this, SAs, SREs, SAEs, and SRS. So a few years ago, the Institute of Chartered Accountants, they started a project to align our audit standards with international auditing standards. And today, these all the numberings, all the formats, everything is almost equal to the standards or auditing, which are international standards. There are certain areas where we have a slight difference. Like, for example, in India, we have joint auditor audit engagements at various places, which is slightly different from what is there in international standards. So these are the numbers, like Sanjeevji has already spoken about SQC1, quality controls for firms that perform audit and review. So this SQC1 becomes very, very important and extremely critical for all the firms which are involved in assurance practice, which are doing some kind of audits, which are doing some kind of certification work. Then standards on auditing, SA 200-810, which is applicable for, where when you are doing historical financial information. So you are doing an audit, which format you should give your audit report. So if it is a statutory audit, you know that you apply standard on auditing 700, 701, 706, 720. So these standards, they are all coming under this category. So of late, there had been a lot of discussion around 720. This standard on auditing wants the auditor to consider information which are accompanying the financial statements. So I'll make it a little more easy for you to understand. So when you sign off the financial statement and give your audit report, your opinion, as a general practice in a smaller firm, the directors make their director's report and then an annual report is submitted to the regulator. So all that director reports and annual reports, they also contain certain information about the companies. Now, standard on auditing 720 requires you to consider that information also while reaching to your conclusion on the true and fairness of the financial statements. And specifically, like in the new CARO 2020, which will now be applicable from the next year, but it is there. The guidance note on this new CARO is being prepared, and clause 319 of that CARO requires an auditor to point out to give an opinion whether the liability is existing as on date of balance sheet, will be able to, so those liabilities that are due within 1 year, whether the company will be able to meet those liabilities. An auditor will form that opinion on the basis of financial ratios, on the basis of estimate dates of realization of assets and liability payments, and other information accompanying the financial statements. So all these standards on auditing 570, where we are talking about going concern, standard on auditing 720, where you are talking about information which is accompanying the financial statements. So those informations are required to be seen by the auditor. Now there are practical challenges which come, especially when we are doing audit of a private limited company or a smaller company. So they say that we sign off the audit report, practically, director's report is prepared after that and annual report is submitted after that. It is prepared after that. So these kind of challenges will come our way, but we will need to adhere to the auditing standards. And if we have not seen those information which are accompanying the financial statements, we need to mention somewhere in our report. Then standard on review engagements, they are applied for other audit when you are not giving an audit opinion. Then standards on assurance engagement, where there are other than historical engagement, and standard on related services, SRS 4400 and 4410, where you are in case of engagement for agreed procedure. So generally what happens is when we are getting an assignment, that assignment can be of various kinds. A client can come to you that, okay, you are our statutory auditors. We have taken a cash credit limit from a bank and we have to submit our stock statement to the bank. And the banker is asking that I should get that stock statement certified from a statutory auditor or a CA. And you are going to give an opinion on that. You are going to certify that. So you need to be careful that standards on auditing requires you to draft a report and give along with your certificates. So I will discuss some part of how to give certificates in this presentation. So this is how the structure is. There are 9 standards, which are 200 to 299, which are talking about general principles and responsibilities. There are 6 standards which are talking about risk assessment and responses to assessed risk, 300 to 499. Then, as Sanjeevji also mentioned, there are standards on audit evidence, which are 500 to 599. Then, using the work of others, 3 standards on auditing, 600 to 699. Then audit conclusion and reporting, 700, 701, 706. So there are 6 standards which are talking about it, and then specialized area which are giving standards on auditing for that. So what is the format? Basically, the sanctions, the sections which are there in these standards, they are distinct. There are no bold lettering, and instead we are using the word shall. So as you might have seen in the Companies Act, section 143.9, it tells that each auditor will use the auditing standard, will apply the auditing standards. So these standards are no more a mere guidance which comes out of the institute to the members on while doing audit, you need to take care of the certain areas, which was the matter in the past. Now, after Companies Act 2013, the auditing standards are part of the Act. It is mandated by the Act that the auditor will apply these auditing standards. So basic structure of every standard is that there will be introduction, there will be scope and objective, date of effectiveness, the basic principles, like I mentioned, that shall word has been used in these standards. It is not, so somebody may say that what is so important about using the word shall. So earlier, there was a word called should. Before that it was may. So from may to should and from should to shall, there is a compulsion, there is a requirement that you will be using, the... how to use these standards. So application of standards. So we had discussed about materiality levels, and after tolerable error level. So there has to be a report of in case there are errors found, whether you want to give a qualified or a modified opinion, whether you want to put a disclaimer in the report order, or whether you want to put a adverse report. So as an auditor, it is very, very critical to, look at the materiality. So in some cases we have seen, when we do central audit and there are some small branches which are being audited. So we see that in order to, be extra careful, the branch auditor will write certain matters, in their audit reports. So like, for example, no expense vouchers are authorized or signed by the head of that branch. So those kind of remarks, when they come in the report, it becomes very difficult for central auditor to consider that, and many times the central auditor will give the report back to the branch auditor and say that okay, you get this, or to will tell the management that please get this qualification removed. So basically the standards are given to help the auditor decide how to do the work. Also, as you can see, as you have observed in past few years, there is a clear change in the perception of society. What auditor is doing? So I'll share an example with you. I was invited to give, a talk to SFIO group. So when I started my presentation, one participant who was a very senior person in SFIO group, he said that when the auditor had already certified a financial statement and they had given their report, why the fraud happened in that company? He took name of a very famous fraud. So then I stopped my presentation and I started telling him that, please look at, read the report what auditor has written. So what this guy has done is given his opinion. He has not certified those financial statements. But as you can see that, you know, the perception of society is changing day by day. So these auditing standards are required because whatever work you are doing, you know, they need to be, you know, close to what the standards are. And in case the society is changing their perception, perhaps we need to change the auditing standards themselves. Then all the chartered accountants, everybody who is providing these assurance service, they need to have a consistency. And there should not be disparity in the services which other people are giving. So there is a need of consistency. That is why there are standards which are standards are required. And representation on international consensus on good quality management practices is also one of the reasons. The purpose is of auditing standard is to give principles, set out basic principles, provide a framework and establish the basis for evaluation of assurance performance. And more important and the significant part is guidance to the members. Then consistent practices adopted across the profession is also one of the purpose of these standards. Then I'm coming to SA 210, agreed upon the terms of engagement, which is popularly known as engagement letter also. Basically, this is a written document which we obtain from the management, you know, for before, you know, before starting the work. We get this engagement letter before starting the work. It is prepared by the auditor for the management and get it signed from the management. An appropriate form is there for auditor to protect in case there are future disputes or future, inconsistencies of discussions. So the reason for this engagement letter is to establish the base on which audit has to be performed, whether, there is a common understanding and what exactly the kind of work auditor will do and what will be the deliverable. So this is preconditions are mentioned that in this standard that determination of applicable financial reporting framework is acceptable. Whether the financial statements which are being audited, whether they are prepared as per Indian GAAP, as per US GAAP. So basically the framework is defined before you start your terms of engagement, it's very, very critical. When we are practicing as chartered accountants or whether we are getting into any engagement, it is very, very, it's very normal to have your terms written on a piece of paper so that, there is no dispute in the future. So obtain the agreement from the management regarding their obligations of, so it is obligation of the management to prepare and present the financial statement and establishment of internal controls. So we see challenges coming in small audits and the smaller CA firms when they get into an engagement, the perception or, the mindset of the company is that auditor will help us preparing the financial statement also. But your terms of engagement should be very clear. If you are doing an audit, the preparation and presentation of financial statement is the responsibility of the management. Establishing internal control is the responsibility of the management. Your responsibility as an auditor is to basically provide your opinion. This opinion is based on books and accounts. It is based on other document, relevant information. It is based on your auditing procedures. So you need to define what is the responsibility of the management and what is the responsibility of the auditor. The engagement letter format it's clear. So basically, there is no specific format is given in the standard, but it generally, it should contain the objective, the scope, the responsibility of management, applicable framework, and audit report format expected. Some of the firms, they put some other terms and conditions. And I would share with you those three areas which I think you should all have in your engagement letters. These three matters are very critical, very important. Large firms, they use these terms in their engagement letters. Smaller firms, they miss out on these part. And I would recommend that you please note down these. Number one, a lot of communication is happening through email and the data is being floated, through emails. And the risk of communication, that risk is risk of the management. So you are doing audit, you are taking the assignment, and there is an understanding between the management and the auditor that risk of communicating through electronic mode, you are not responsible in case there is any breach in between. Number two, jurisdiction. When you are getting into an engagement, please discuss with the client. It will not look like a very material item, but trust me that it matters a lot. Say in your engagement letter that we are getting into this engagement and jurisdiction will be Maharashtra or Delhi or Mumbai, whichever the courts, wherever your offices are. And the third part is when you're getting into an engagement, let us say you are giving a certificate to the management and you're charging a small fees for that. And tomorrow, if there is a dispute or if that person takes you to the court of law, that because of this certificate, I got into huge losses with the third party. So please limit your liability to one time the fees which you have received for that assignment. So it is very important for auditor to mention these terms. So I'm sharing it from my own experience and the practice which is being followed by a large number of companies, large number of CA firms. So it is good that you put those conditions in your engagement letters. Then in case there are modifications of the terms, you have signed an engagement letter and there are some modifications requested by the management, you please check whether these modifications are reasonable or not. If reasonable, then issue the new engagement letter. If not, then continue with the existing. So there is a small question whether an auditor can issue combined engagement letter for different years. The answer to this question is no. Opinion is issued separately for each in this particular case, and hence the engagement letter should also be separate. There's another question: when an audit was completed in a hurry, as the regulator wanted to publish the result quickly, whether the engagement letter may be signed later, maybe after the date of audit report? No, as Sanjeev Ji also mentioned in his presentation, that these engagement letters have to begin with the these have to be taken before starting of the engagement. So there are some comments in the charts. So some Vinita said, can you would appreciate if you can share the wording in the legal terms would be appreciated. I think we are all qualified CAs and we know our English, so we can draft those languages. If you want, I can share what language we use in our firm so that I can share with you later. Communication through electronic mode means when you are sending an email, it goes through some server and then there is somebody who hacks onto that server and get the information leaked. So so that particular risk is already there. So, okay. So I move further. Written representation. this is a significant skin saver for the auditors. A written statement or a written representation letter is required to be taken before you sign off anything. Section SA 580 talks about it. It says that written statement has to be taken. It has to be issued to the auditor by the management or those charged with governance to confirm certain matters or to support other audit evidence. So these are basically known as MRL or management representation letter. But we need to be careful. Many places I have seen that engagement letters are signed and then representation is taken as a mere formality. But please remember, this is not a formality. This is a significant thing which you obtain from the management in addition to your audit evidence. This is not an alternate to the audit evidence. This is in addition to your audit evidence. So I was having a casual talk with one of my friends. He said that, there was a discussion going on and there was one item on which auditor was not able to get any evidence on that particular line item. So he just asked the management to give a representation. And he was checking whether this MRL is sufficient for me or not. So basically, MRL is a representation by the management. Also, please note that the balance sheet and profit and loss account and notes to accounts are already signed by the management. So they are prepared by the management. They are signed by the management. We as chartered accountant, as the auditors, are doing audit of those financial statements or the information which is appearing there. And we are gathering audit evidence. And wherever in addition to evidence you want any representation from the management, that can be taken. One significant point is, again, going back to Standard on Auditing 570, going concern. There are subsidiaries which are foreign subsidiaries and many times they have issue around the going concern. So they take representation letter. So they take letter of support from the management, from their head office, that in case required, they will be able to fulfill, they will be able to fund more. And, auditors take those support letters on their record and then ask the management to give a representation. So basically, matters on which MRL should be obtained is there can be an undertaking by the management that it has fulfilled the responsibilities regarding preparation of the financial statements, which are prepared as per the applicable framework, agreed terms on the engagement letters. So they have taken care of the internal controls. They have provided the relevant details to the auditors. And whatever transactions have been recorded in the books of accounts, they are complete. We have not hidden anything, those kind of things. But very, very important is that the auditor will need to obtain this representation from the management, not as a substitute of the audit evidence. This is to support the audit evidence. And what is the auditor duty? To evaluate the reliability of the written representation. So, auditor will need to apply the professional's judgment and the professional skepticism, that whatever representation is given by the management, whether this is true or not, whether this is correct or not, whether this is fair presentation or not. So there may be a situation that management is prepared, management has prepared the financial statements and there are sundry debtors which are appearing in that statement. And those debtors are more than 10 years old and no movement is happening in those debtors. Management is giving you a representation that these debtors are recoverable. So how will you take that? You need to have your own audit procedures to understand whether such kind of a representation is reliable or it is not reliable. So there may be, there may be some situations where management is involved in a fraud. And if they are misrepresenting the facts in the financial statements, they will also certainly misrepresent the facts in their management representation letter also. So you need to be careful. You need to carry out your own procedures and take these representations as a, you know, as a support. And in case you as auditors have any doubt on reliability or on inconsistency with other audit evidence, then you will need to extend your audit procedures. So like Sanjeev ji very nicely explained how to increase your sample size if you find an error or a mistake. And then if you conclude as auditor that representation or they are not reliable, you need to take appropriate action. And in case required, you need to mention it in the report also. So when the auditor concludes that sufficient doubts about the integrity of the management or written representation is not reliable, or management does not provide the written representation, then you need to decide whether you want to stay in the engagement and issue your report mentioning all these facts, or you want to withdraw from the engagement. So basically, in some places, you may like to give disclaimer of your opinion also. So number three question is whether written representation is sufficient and appropriate evidence by itself. Can they substitute an audit procedures? So the answer I have already explained, that through MRL although MRL provides necessary evidence, they do not provide sufficient and appropriate evidence on their own. They are supporting your audit procedures. Another question is, an audit report was issued without obtaining MRL in the last year. Can the auditor take MRL now after 1 year? What should be periods covered in that MRL? So that should be, before you sign off your financials, your audit report, you need to take that kind of representation. Not after you have already signed. The written representation shall be for the periods referred to in the audit report itself. Now I come to, this guidance note on reports or certificates for the special purpose. Many times auditors are asked, or as practicing CAs, we are asked to give this certificate, that certificate. Sir, I have to apply for visa. Can you give me a certificate that, you know, the assets and liabilities of my family? So what should be format of those? So there is a guidance note which you can always refer to. And this guidance note provides you guidance on how to issue those certificates. And basically, wherever you are giving any kind of assurance that, okay, whatever statement these people have put, so I have carried out my audit procedures and this is my opinion. So then you will be using this guidance note. And there are certain scope out of this guidance note. Wherever the other standards on related services or other SRSs are applicable, don't apply this guidance note. And when you are preparing the tax returns, so there is no assurance. You are not giving any opinion. You are not giving any conclusion. You are helping the client in filing their tax returns. So this guidance note is not for that purpose. Consultancy or advisory engagements, management consulting and engagements. This guidance note is not for that. It is basically for giving any certificate. So basically, you need to have very specific wording, the level of assurance, which whatever you want to convey, you need to be very clear in your certificate. And there are inherent limitations also which are attached to your procedures which you had carried out. So like nature of reporting, so whether you have used a sample to test that. Like for example, there is a huge stock and you have picked up some samples. So you have used sampling techniques. Whether you have relied on the internal controls, and there are certain limitations which you have which are inherent in those internal controls. So your evidence which were available to you, whether they were conclusive, whether they were persuasive, you need to mention all these, so basically whatever procedures you are carrying out, there are certain limitations which are always there. You need to be careful about those. And then these engagements, which are assurance engagement, where you are giving certificates, there are certain objectives which are mentioned in the guidance note. I'll quickly, these recording will be there, so these slides are already being, will be there with you. I'll just quickly skip some of the theoretical part. So basically, as an auditor or as a person who is giving your opinion or conclusion or giving a certificate, you will need to mention the context of the engagement. You should consider all relevant evidence, whether it supports or contradicts the evaluation. So there may be a situation that, you know, there are certain evidence which are in favor of what you are trying to say, and there are certain evidence which are not in favor. You need to consider all of those and should obtain all necessary evidence to support the opinion. So the situation comes, you know, when you are giving a certificate on the basis of guidelines of a regulator. For example, RBI may issue a format of the report and they ask you to give to sign of that report. What happens in that case? So basically, we had discussed this particular issue because when you are making your report in accordance with this guidance note, then you are giving the title, you are giving the addressee, you are giving the identification, level of assurance obtained, you are identifying the criteria, identifying the responsible parties, giving performer, whatever you have given. So you have also mentioned about SQC1, ICI code of ethics, then your conclusion, restriction of use, and then you put your signature, date and name, and then also UDIN. You give all these and your client says, no, sir, I don't want all of these. The RBI says that please give in this format only, or the department where I have to give my certificate, it wants a specific language in that. What do you do in that case? So we had discussed that as per the guidance note, you have to prepare certificate in a particular manner in accordance with this guidance note. So you issue your report according to this guidance note and submit to the regulator. And if they still do not accept it, then you issue another one in their format. That's the solution which we could find out. So trust me, we are doing audit of, we are helping large number of government departments. So many places where there is a certificate required for fund utilization or those kind of certificates. When we prepared our draft and shared it with the client, they went ahead and shared it with the department. When they read through the content, they said it is fine. So even though they wanted the certificate in a particular format, and trust me, many times those languages which are there, in those previous certificates, they were basically, somebody had given them the certificate in some point of time and they are using the same certificate language all across the years. So we need to bring that change. We need to, adhere to the guidance which has been given. And it is basically for our own advantage. So if I say that, okay, I have to, let us say the same example, give a report on asset and liability of the people who want to apply for some to the some department or something. Then if I'm giving all of these things, the title, addresses, whatever the context, whatever procedures I have carried out, why it is, it is supposed to be used in which manner, then I'm putting signatures and everything I'm giving. So basically making it elaborate that when I am signing a paper, there is certain procedures which I have carried out, and it's not just stamping and signing. So this guidance note is a very, very important part. And I think you guys, all the practicing CAs, they can read this guidance note and understand the context. So I think I've crossed the time. Thank you so much. I hope it was a little bit of use to all of you.
Yeah, it is a wonderful session. There are a few queries. I will share my screen. You please. Okay. It is visible.
So, how to conclude on cases where the rent payment is happening to related parties, but there is no document signed? The rent terms seem consistently over the years, and despite communicating to the management, nothing has been done over past 3 years. The rent payment is happening to related parties, but there is no document signed. I can tell you this practical situation had come to in one of our clients also, and we told them that this particular item is also subject to GST. And as per GST requirement, you need to have a written document. So when we told them, and then they had a discussion with the GST consultant, and then they came out that yes, they need to have a written document for that. I think this is very, very critical part. So whether partner is holding few hundred shares of a large listed company for long period as investment, whether the firm can accept internal audit assignment. So I think Sanjeev ji can answer this question. In my opinion, he cannot. But in case Sanjeev ji has a difference,
No, he'll not be able to hold.
Yeah. So my opinion is also no. So third is, can engagement letter and management letter be digitally signed? What procedures to be ensured in such a case? Can we get approval from the management to attach DSC per mail to mitigate risk of misuse of DSC? I think this is very important part, because the institute has come up with this guidance, and they have allowed digitally signed presentation letters. So digitally signed is perfectly fine. So fourth is, if a company is in CIRP, so I think it is with resolute professional taking care of operations and admin of the company, where RP can issue and sign the MRL. What if the RP refuses to issue the MRL? Whether MD can issue MRL, and what if both of them refuses to issue MRL? So I am not expert in insolvency practice, but I know that when resolute professional is appointed, this person becomes in charge of the company. Managing director has no role play in this. So the representation letter has to come from resolution professional, and if they refuse to sign, then you need to enhance your audit procedures, and whether you want to rely on the statements or the evidence, and you need to mention somewhere about why this person is not giving you. So you need to carry out your own judgment. Why this person is not signing on? Whether there is anything behind which is not using your eye. So engagement letter required separate for standalone and CFS. So engagement letter can be one, but representation letter has to be separate, and also separate for your tax audits. So Sanjeev, you may like to add to this?
No, this is fine. I mean, both the practices are there. Like, I am fine that even if the engagement letter is one for standalone CFS as well as the tax audit. So there are different firms who follow different practices. But even one letter which mentions separately the fee for all is also fine.
Okay, thank you. Almost each and every question has been answered. It is a good idea to explain the topic of narrating a story. Every participants like this idea very much.
Thank you,
the speakers, for the wonderful session. I now request Deputy Convener C.A. Krishna Kumar ji to formally give a vote of thanks to both the speakers.
Thank you, Simaji. Am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you, Simaji, for giving me this opportunity. Today's learned speakers, CA Dr. Sanjeev Singhalji, Central Council member from Northern Region, and CA Sri Praveen Kumarji has very well covered today's topic on standard on audit key consideration in financial statements and also made it very lively by giving several practical examples. Mr. Singhal have majorly covered data analysis, journal entry testing tools, materiality and sampling. And Mr. Praveen Kumarji has covered auditing standard in engagement letters, MRL written representation, guidance note on report or certificates. On behalf of JV Nagar CP Study Circle, I propose a hearty vote of thanks for today's both the speakers, Sanjeev Singhalji and Praveen Kumarji. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. It was a very wonderful session.
Thank you very much. It was heartening to see 400 participants and still there are 348.